Hello everyone. I am pleased to welcome you to this conference, which is part of the cycle called Human Territories and Societies. This cycle aims to promote French researchers' work on humanities in and about Indonesia. So as you can see, every month until November, but also December, we will welcome a scientist on very different topics. Tonight's lectures will be presented by Eric Fréquent, who is assistant professor at the French Naval Academy. He is also coordinator of the Observatory on Southeast Asia within the Asia Center in Paris, and a member of the EU Committee of the Council for Security Cooperation in the Asia Pacific. Today, Eric Fréquent is conducting research on piracy and armed robbery against ships, Southeast Asia, and more generally the roles of the navies in geopolitics of oceans. Before I start, two more few things. I'd like to thank our partners, the French School for Asian Studies and Comunitas Historia Indonesia. And tell you that the presentation will last about 40 minutes and will be followed by 30 minutes of Q&A and then a light refreshment in the lobby to continue the discussion in a less formal way. Please give a warm welcome to Eric Fréquent.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you very much for this very nice introduction, and thank you very much, because I'm very happy to be with you tonight, but I have to admit that I'm also a bit malu, as you would say, because when I see the name of the big name of the next speaker will come later, I saw Jérôme Tadier, Sarah Andrieux, and Gabriel Facal, who are a brilliant researcher, so I will try to do my best today. And also I'm a bit malu, because usually I'm more at ease, you know, staying in the kampung far away from Jakarta, along the Malacca Strait, along the sea, and being with you tonight is like, I don't know, I feel performing in the Madison Square Garden, or, you know, Olympia, the French people would say, but again, I will try to do my best. And so I'm malu, but I'm also very happy, so I will to share my research with you. And also, I have to admit that sometime, now I'm based in Singapore, and sometime I'm, how should I say, rindu orang ramah dari Indonesia, because Singapore is nice, but, you know, sometimes I miss Indonesian people and enjoying talking and chatting with them over coffee and copy. So that's why it was for me very great opportunity to be in Jakarta with you tonight, and also very happy to talk about piracy. So and to tell you this story, because I mean, for me, but I hope that for you as well tonight later. Fascinating topic, because the idea is not only to try to know who is hiding behind the mask. You know, like in Wayang Kulit, you have the Wayang Kulit, but also with the Dalang behind. So this is the first idea. And then also to see that it's not only this issue, this question, but also what those piracy said about Indonesia in particular, but Southeast Asia in general, because there is something to learn from piracy in Southeast Asia. So next, please. So to start with, some facts and figures, the statistics. So we'll try to go quickly and because of 40 minutes, but just to tell you, to know that there is a pendant, that's all, about piracy. You know, there is a saying in Africa, I think it's Cameroon, no? A lion never dies, it sleeps. So it's roughly the same for piracy, because sooner or later, pirates will be back. Never ever, please say like this lawyer, I remember in 1930s, oh, piracy is obsolete. Even the French lawyer, you know, who cancelled the law on piracy just before the event in Somalia. So that's why you had this big decrease of piracy until 2009, and then suddenly increase until 2015, and then again now you have a decreasing, but for Southeast Asia there is a slight increase for the last year, not only in Indonesia but also Philippines. Even if for the Malacca Strait now it's quite safe, in spite of this peak, we'll see later why. So this is the quantity, I would say, but then what about the quality of the attacks? Talking about the hijacking, because this is a key issue to decipher, you know, to analyze statistics, especially the sources. This is the International Maritime Bureau, so later in the Q&A, we can talk about these different statistics, because they have sometimes an agenda behind. You have to check who is funding these agencies. But yeah, the key is to see how many hijackings. So, and as you can see, Indonesia, Malaysia, Singapore Strait, less and less for the last year. Next, please. So, and just to illustrate what I was just saying, this is a fact and figures, but what to see behind this, beyond these statistics, we can see that piracy, actually, it's a very broad issue because it deals with not only poor fishermen in their kampong along the Malacca Strait, so there is this human dimension, you know, not too far from anthropology, I would say, but then you have also after to deal with big power and how China, America, and even France now, I don't know, Australia maybe later, try to work with this issue, to use piracy as a pretext for some initiative. So that's why this is the beauty of political science, to pick, you know, a bit everywhere in anthropology when you deal with these fishermen, why do they switch to piracy sometimes? And then also how piracy is just a tool for diplomats or Ministry of Defense. Before I forget, there was an asterisk on the first slide. Because when I say piracy, actually, and that's why it's also a good example to show you that actually it's a bit complex. Piracy, technically, according to the law of the sea, it's only on the high seas. But the big issue is that you have many attacks, incidents in the territorial waters. And EEZ, Exclusive Economic Zone, it's also a big, another issue. But just that's why armed robberies against ships, it's for all the incidents in territorial waters, and piracy is for everything in the high seas. But just to go faster, if I may, I will use the word piracy. Even if I have to admit, and this is a risk, or we have to keep it in mind, sometimes people use the word piracy to make it a bit more, you know, trendy, and so that's why we have to be careful, because the people we'll meet now are maybe pirates, but not the hero or the Robin Hood that we read the story maybe previously. Next, please. So having said that, the milestone for the presentation tonight, the puzzle issue, that's it, and this is, as I say in the title, the everlasting, you know, sometimes an epic face-off between the state and the pirates, or the state and the, versus the non-state actors, and so who's going to win, and or something like that. And my idea is that on one end, for sure, the state is challenged, mistreated, because of all these pirates attack, and because who has now the authority, you have local potentates, and then the state is kicked out, the state or the representative, and no more legitimacy, etc. But on the other hand, precisely because of this threat, the state has to train forces to be better equipped, and it's like, you know, antibodies. And at the end of the day, even if it was a big challenge for the state, maybe it can be, at the end of the day, stronger. I mean, that's maybe the hypothesis, let's say. And to go further, so for tonight's presentation, we'll have three points. I mean, you know, like the typical policy brief, I mean, let's say statements, analysis, and then what to do. But first, we will try to see who the pirates are, precisely, behind the mask, and behind the curtain, the dalang, etc. And then after, we will see, okay, we have this threat, these people, but how to now to analyze and to explain these trends up and down, because sometimes the newspaper, or even in ministerial statement, you have always the same explanation, yeah, patrol, trilateral patrol, but is it only this? The only explanation, we'll see. And then there will be the to-do list for the next stage in the near future. Is it okay? Do you sign and agree to continue. So let's go. Next, please. And with the first part, who are the pirates? Usually, I differentiate two kind of pirates to go faster. And you know, it's an allusion to the Aesop or La Fontaine fable, the town mouse and the sea, the country mouse, because it's something like that. And you have indeed the town pirates, and the town pirates. All these people actually are Indonesian people who moved, sometimes migrated from their either from their mountain, most of the time in Sumatra, and then going to the cities along the Malacca Strait. And they went, why? Because usually no job in the big cities, like for example Palembang. So okay, no job there. But in the same time, they heard about, you know, the free trade zones, the free trade areas, the economic specific economic zones in the former growth triangle. You know, the growth triangle, Sijori, Singapore, Johor, Riau, and so they moved there, thinking, okay, over there should be factories, job. Let's go, because no job in my city, or sometimes only one crop, you know, harvest rice, paddy in the paddy field. As a petani in the mountain, so for the same reason, for them it's better to move to the big cities. These people in the city, in the town, they are those who perpetrate hijacking. This is an example, old picture, but this is a shipping company who gave it to me. This was a famous case, because just to explain how it works, this was a petrol ranger. And then after pirates hijacked this ship, this tanker, and then, you know, they used the black to hide the previous name, and then to write in a very small letter, white letter, will be the new name. So just to say that Petrol Ranger technically disappeared, and then there was a new ship coming from nowhere, there will be, of course, there was corruption, accomplice within this case was in China, but with Indonesian pirates. But now you still have this kind of event sometimes, but less and less, and with a much smaller merchant vessel. We will see why later, because now you have equipment on board, so it's easier to track the ship. Even if you have pirates on board, you can still see where your ship is. So that's why the pirates now have to proceed much faster. And actually, how does it work? If I may, we'll go quickly. So you have these people looking for a job in let's say in Batam, because this is Batam is a hub for piracy. You know, Batam in the south, just in the south of Singapore and along the Malacca and the Singapore Straits. And then so they drink coffee, waiting for a job, because at night or in the morning they worked in the dusty market, and then now they've raised, they expect a better job. And then in the same time you have, let's say, a godfather, but even if you don't have a proper hierarchical, very formal mafia group, it's more informal, with a freelance pirate. But you have this guy who has connection coming from Malaysia, Singapore, with connection within the shipping company, can get intelligence over there. Soon there will be this tanker moving from there to there. Okay, I have somebody from my gang into this company, part of the crew. Let's check the price of oil. Okay, if we wait for a while, oil, the price will be better. He said, okay, I want to hijack this tanker this date. Okay, and then he gave a call to his colleague, partner, I don't know what, in Batam. Hey guy, I need 15 people for the, 23rd of March. Can? No problem. So then the guy in Batam, okay, he called his other friend in the copy precisely, and then saying, I need 15 people for the 23rd of March. And then the guy in the copy, anybody free for the 23rd of March? Yes, no. Me, so far, nothing to do, okay. And then when he... the 15 people, then they will meet together, and actually we know the place, because it's quite famous. And then after they go to the, they have to meet to Berkumpul, the gather in a hotel, so same in Batam, some hotel, and then over there they wait. And By chance, this one of the hotel was the hotel where I was sleeping because it was a very cheap hotel. And then the manager told me stories about that because he said then after they come to my hotel and then the big boss bring money to them. With the money, they rent some pans, they buy oil. Sometimes they rent a gun, but it's very rare. Usually they prefer to use parang machetes. And then after you have the manager of the hotel who bring them to the Pelabuhan Tikus, you know, this informal, illegal harbor. And then from there, they go, they attack the ship, they hijack the ship. And actually it's very interesting because they don't stay on the ship so long because quickly you have another crew coming to take over, meaning the pirate, even if they are caught, they cannot say what happened to the ship because they don't know. They left the ship quickly. And then you have the other crew, and this crew can bring, so it depends now they have to proceed faster. But actually, this manager, I mean, manager, if you see the hotel, worked as a crew number two, let's say, because he said, yeah, I had to go one day to Bangkok and from Bangkok to the South China Sea, and then I spent 2 months in the South China Sea. Why? Because we had meeting in the middle of nowhere, the South China Sea, just to sell part of the cargo. So this is what usually this town pirate do. So Mr. Wong was a Singaporean who was caught in Batam, precisely, and then I met him in his prison in Pekanbaru. Mr. Pong, this was a big name, but so far, but then no news about him, but was very active in the area. And but this was previously. Yeah? And so that's all. Next, please, because if I tell all my life. So this is just to tell you precisely the flow of parrot from their dry paddy fields, where only one crop per year, and then they move to Jambi, Palembang, Lampung, and then from there you have in blue, this is the main cities, where they precisely do their own network, and then after they can move to the Pelabuhan Tikus, and then from there to perpetrate their attack. Next, please. Actually, yeah. No, let's go faster to move to the country pirate. This one is very different. This one is a local people. They are just, let's say, opportunists, amateur. And but they better know, they are more familiar with the maritime environment than the previous one. The previous one, sometimes I told you, they are just farmer who moved to Batam to find a job, even to swim they cannot. These people are either taxi boat in the time, fishermen, but you know, because of all the traffic or sometimes the shipyards in Batam, so you have less and less fish, so sometimes they have to find I went to one night to fish with them. One night in the Malacca Strait, we nearly died. There was a huge container ship and we had no more light going straight to us. And so much risk to get what? For, you know, the chumichumi, the cuttlefish, and one fish like that. And the guy, two kids at home to feed. So that's why, indeed, sometimes say, hey, come on, we have so many people doing piracy, why not we should be able to do the same? And actually, when you see them, because sometimes they explain to you, so how do they proceed, you see that they are not professional, and you see that they are also quite scared, because going at sea at night without any life jacket or any light to climb on board, so now, that's why. Sometimes, oh yeah, that intelligence. No, they just wait for the very slow and low ship. And then if there is not so much light, easy target, easy prey, so they attack the ship. And on board, they will just take quickly the wallet, the salary, but less and less because now there is automatic transfer. But anything they can sell again after in Batam. But as you can see, it's very close to... this is Singapore, so it's this is a narrowest point position in the Malacca Strait, and within this community, so you have on one island 4, 5, 6 gangs. It depends on the golden age of piracy or now much less. But during the golden age, for example, you had two guys One was very violent, and nobody dared to talk because they said, "Oh no, no! But if he listens to me, if he knows that I talk to you after, he will beat my wife or my family, etc." And there was another one who actually was killed by this previous guy, much more violent, who was very different, was like the local hero and considered like the local Robin Hood, meaning he's stealing money to the rich to give it to the poor or to the village. And actually, all this. Houses and stills were funded by piracy, by attack at sea, and even the mosque in the center funded by the pirates. Next, please. This is a mixed between two kind of pirates, because sometimes you have pirates coming from the cities, but they stay for a while in the compound along the sea. The one I mentioned, for example, the guy. I was eating a dog to get information, and then because he was showing me the house over there, saying, yeah, sometimes they come from Batam, but they meet here for a while, few weeks, and then after they use, like in Somalia, a mothership, and then with the mothership they will move from Batam or the small island nearby to Anambas Island, and previously they stayed in this village, but now no more, and they stay off this island. And then they wait for the same easy target, and that's why you had clusters of attacks, because for 4 or 5 days you had 5 or 6 attacks, and then that's all. And then they went back to Batam, spend money, and that's why I use this picture, like Catch Me If You Can, because for a while they stay here, but then Malacca Strait Patrol. Okay, never mind. Let's go to Off Tioman. Yeah, but after the Malaysian Maritime Enforcement Agency. Yeah, patrolled over there. So, okay, let's move to Anambas. And then, Indonesia, na-na-na. So, let's move to Natuna. And then, the sea is so big. I mean, so the pirates will be always ahead the law enforcement agencies. Next, please. Yeah, next, because after you have a hot topic about maritime terrorism. And not that easy. And actually, it's interesting because this was a hot topic in taboo in the 2004, 2005 for Al-Qaeda, and now it could come back because of ISIS and Daesh. Because always you have the same issue. On one hand, people say, yeah, let's be careful, Al-Qaeda is back, Al-Qaeda is here, now ISIS. You have like the second front of terror. You have all this, literature, this book, published, even especially, I would say, maybe in Singapore, second front of terror, the Talibanization of Indonesia. So it was a bit too much. You had also this alert. This was in 2010 in Singapore. Be careful, possible terror attack in the Malacca Strait. Well, yeah, and then I brought it. I bought it. Hukum Jihad. This was in le droit law of jihad. And yet, then you have a chapter saying, no need to say in Bahasa, but saying that if you do perpetrate one attack at sea, it's like 10 attacks on land, meaning go at sea much better. Don't know, you will get more room over there, upstairs, I don't know, will be much better. So, meaning, because they push people to go at sea, and plus, they found documents sometime in Pakistan or wherever, or even in the Al-Qaeda magazine saying, yeah, we have to target now maritime traffic at sea. And then to sustain, you had this book, this is the difference, between an expert and a researcher. I mean, actually, it was by a former journalist, I love journalists, but because precisely it was a bit trendy in this time, you say, yeah, let's be careful, we have a maritime attack, terror attack at sea. But that's the beauty of this topic. That's what I said previously. You have to zoom out, because in the same time you had Hu Jintao talking about the Malacca dilemma for China. Okay, so knowing that, you will say, maybe let's find a pretext to patrol in the Malacca Strait. Wonderful, maritime terrorism. So then they said, and when I wanted to meet people at the American embassy in Singapore, people said, no, but meet this person, meaning it was like an official spokesman for for US interest. So, and that's why at the end of the day, there was a, like, a, how should I say, yeah, the maritime terrorism was like a pretext for some other initiative in the Malacca Strait. But that's true that also you had previous attacks on Limburg, USS Cole. So that's why you have all this argument to say, yeah, let's be careful. But in the same time, the idea was about the possible collusion between pirate and terrorism. And this is more tricky because much less obvious, because actually the pirates, this is their interest is totally opposite. I mean, terrorism want advertisement and to publicize their attack, etc. Pirates, this is the opposite. Low profile, they don't want to make noise. So that's why it's a bit different. And then also it's very interesting, you had this unofficial, actually the chief of the village, who was saying, actually me, I know everybody here, I can tell you who is a pirate, who is not a pirate. And it was funny because in the same time he said, I know the governor. So I say, if you know the pirate, you know the governor. I don't know, maybe you can do something. He said, no, it's not that easy, because at least by doing this, penchurian, voyez, petty seals, meaning just stealing money, wallet, etc. They have something to eat, to survive, etc. In the same time, I know that people on board, they won't be killed, they won't be injured, and insurances will reimburse. So far, we can manage. But he said, but if one day I see terrorists coming into my village, this is very different, and I will give a call to Jakarta to say, please, now, you cannot, you have to do something. That's why, actually, more or less, it was under control. The situation was under control. Plus, to conduct this kind of attack at sea, actually, it's very difficult. That's why maritime terrorism is not that obvious. I met Nasir Abbas, who was a former emir of Jemaah Islamia, and I said, so maritime terrorism? He said, actually, no, because it's very difficult, and it's much easier to do anything in a pub, you know, than trying to do something at sea, either in the middle of nowhere and nobody will care, no media report, or it will be too far from downtown, I don't know. But that's why it's not that obvious. But at the end of the day, let's say that we have still to keep it in mind, of course, because, for example, especially attack at berth for port of call of Navy ship, this indeed is still, of course, a threat. Plus, what is happening in the Sulu Sea, even if in the Sulu Sea it's very, very complex, because Abu Sayyaf, you don't have any, you don't have one Abu Sayyaf group. Abu Sayyaf, this is a colleague of mine who is based over there, Southern Philippines, told me it's a four group, and within the every group you have 20 to 30 family clan. So meaning, you have those who are just interested in money, those just to be autonomous, those who want to be independent, and those who for the caliphate. So that's why very different agenda. Next, please. So we are done with the first part, who had to be longer, so no worries, about who are the pirates, or armed or sea robbers. You know that now. But now let's try to go one step further and to see, okay, why you had this up and down from 2004 to 2009, and then 2009, 2015, and then since 2015. On one hand, first, indeed, very good initiative who could explain that why, let's say, after the last peak in 2003, until 2009, you had a decrease of piracy, especially in the Malacca Strait, but even in general. And that's true that you had this Malacca Strait patrol initiated, and this was actually a result of what I said earlier, when they said, okay, you have a possible terror attack in the Malacca Strait, so we want to send Marines in the Malacca Strait, and then the little state said, oh, no, so, don't want, please, stay away, we will patrol. So actually it was not that bad, because it pushed the little state to react. And then, so Indonesia, Malaysia and Singapore set up this so first maritime patrol and then air patrol and then network to share intelligence. Then you had also the RECAP. So RECAP, this is a platform, a network of police. This is also, we'll talk about that later, police and Coast Guard. And the idea is to share information faster, so to know each other, to know his colleague in the various countries. Actually, you have 20 countries, and so to be able to share. If you have hijacking in Indonesia, then you don't know where your boat, your vessel will appear later. So you have to inform all your colleagues in ASEAN. So and then to say, oh yeah, but there is indeed a different name, but exact the same shape and color of the boat who was hijacked. So and then they can react. And then you have also the information fusion center with made up of Navy liaison officers, including a French one, Indonesian one, even Chinese one for, now I don't know, but at least for a while. And same, this Navy officer share information. So it looks good. Everything is done to be more responsive. Next, please. And but this is not enough, because sometimes we stop here. But because that's why you have also to go on land sometime to go further, because to deal with the roots, the main causes of piracy. And then maybe we should mention this decentralization reforms. I don't know at the end of the day, but I have to admit that indeed in some Pelabuhan Tikus, you know, this illegal informal harbor I mentioned earlier, sometimes they were like coastal ghettos, you know, cut off from the administrative, economic city centers. But then afterwards, you had the efforts first to jail some corrupted official over there, and then also to I don't know to bring a public light in this compound, then asphalted road as well, then custom office in this far away remote compound. So feeling that the state was back, and also in this time there was an effort, especially by Yudo Yono, to revitalize, see what I mean, the free trade zones in BBK, Batam Bintan Karimun. So, and indeed, this actually is a picture of a French businessman who moved from Singapore to Batam to build his shipyard. So it looks good as well. And also, simply, generational issue. I can tell you, I mean, piracy started roughly, but in 1990s, and then now, let's say we are in 2010, something like that. You don't do the same thing when you was, 20 years later. Me when I was 20 years old, and now, a bit different. So that's why pirates are the same. They don't want to take risk anymore to climb on board of a ship at night. Plus, big change. They have kids. Yeah, because 20 years later. So, and they don't want the kids to see them as a pirate, to visit them in prison, they have an ambition. So they said, and plus, because they read the newspaper, you know, Channel News Asia, you can watch Channel News Asia from in Batam from Singapore. Oh, what? The Malacca Strait Patrol, or some terrific, terrible. Or maybe it's time for me to get retired and to stop these activities. So this also can explain the decrease. Next, please. Last, let's say, concentric circle, the foreign powers, just to say that also, I told you, because of piracy, it's a multi-layered issue, not only people on grassroots people, but also, you know, what happened in the ministerial level. But it's a good opportunity for country to be back, to show the flag, for naval naval diplomacy, defense diplomacy, and then you had all this, for example, this patrol boat given by USA. It was not the Navy, it was not the US Coast Guard, this was ICHITAP, it's another organization, great job. I mean, not only, actually, interesting, because not only in Batam, but also in Tarakan, meaning along the Makassar Strait, so which is two very strategic places. This was a boat given by Japan. All this is a map by Alban Siasia about all the radar offered by USA as well. There was this program, Integrated Maritime Surveillance System. And then later we'll see that maybe France as well has something to offer. But actually, we send, I know, Commissaire de la Marine, for example, to Bacor Camelin a long time ago, and precisely to work on this issue. Next, please. So this sounds good, but if you recall properly, 2009, pirates are back, piracy rise again. And why? Because if you look at properly, carefully, as I said, if you go behind the curtain to see the Dalang, etc., you can see that recap sounds good, but actually Indonesia and Malaysia are not part of recap. They still work together, and still you have people in Indonesia who would love to work closely with RICAP, for example. But still, it's not that smooth, or as smooth as it could be. Plus, RICAP sometimes is good for to publish a report, to organize meeting, but then sometimes you still have people criticizing the effect of RICAP on the field. Then you have all this Malacca Strait Patrol. Sometimes you have the feeling that you have a big gap between what happened at the ministerial level. You share hands, click-clack, and then to say, see, we work together. But then after what happened, you don't see the patrol boats at sea. Or when you ask the people, you know, in his small wooden house, the, I don't know, policeman, navy or whatever, saying, yeah, but you know that sometimes the hot pursuit to cross the border, if you're counterpart, I don't know, your colleague from Malaysia is following a pirate, and then the answer is not automatically, yes, he would be more than welcome, please come and catch him in my own territorial waters. I mean, we know that happened in the past. I mean, you have sometimes always some little fights between our crew, between the countries, so that's why it's not that smooth. And then regarding Indonesia, but ASEAN in particular, IFC sends, I'm not talking about Indonesia actually, but you have some other countries, they are not that keen in sharing information, cooperating, working together. For them, sometimes it's quite new, this kind of cooperation. So again, it's not very smooth. The ISPS code is a code set up, created by... established by the IMO, International Maritime Organization, after 9/11, to say, okay, we know 9/11 what happened, but maybe there could be something like that at sea. So let's prevent. So they said, because of this code, it's compulsory, you have to set up a plan, a safety plan, and with a safety officer on board to be ready if anything happens. But sometimes, you know, you have people that just buy the certificate, the certs or what, but they don't follow the proper training. So this also doesn't help. Plus the issue about equipment, oil. So this is all picture. Huh? Let's be fair, it's not equipment today. But we know that it's a regular issue to get the proper equipment. And not only equipment, but also oil to be able to patrol in over there. And this... sketches just to remind that maybe also ASEAN doesn't push that much precisely to take initiative, could take the lead sometimes, but we see, and actually it's a big concern now, not a concern, but people realize that you have this move from regionalism to minilateralism, and we'll see later when you have only three countries which... next, please. Another factor to explain why the pirates were back, the nostalgia, because I told you some of the main chief of gang moved away. They said, okay, me, I'm done now. Or one of them went back to Sulawesi to do business in paper. Another one built his peasant train in Java, etc. But then after a few years, missing Batam, missing... life over there, missing attacks, and then all these people came back, and then they came back precisely when there was this rise of piracy. That's why it's, as I said, never dies; it just slips or go away, but then come back. And then always the same issue on the BBK free trade zones mission, non fully accomplished. I met actually the previous head of Batam Autoritas, and then he told me a lot about this fight between all the administrative leaders over there. And so you know that there is a potential, something to do, but again, it takes a lot of time, especially when you see what happened in Iskandar area or whatever, wherever. So that's why you have many factors. If you can check all these indicators since 2013, until 2013, still improving. But then, since then, talking about logistics and equipment, it's much worse. Next, please. Thankfully, maybe, let's finish on a more optimistic view, the state could be back again. That's interesting, with the help of non-state actors. There is nobody mentioned about piracy, the work of NGO, and maybe because there is not so much, but you have some, actually even a French one, with a French volunteer over there. I'm thinking about the MEP, for example, and doing a lot precisely to take care of the young kids, because again, I mean, I did the same in Paris, but you have the choice, either this or that. If nobody helps you to go there, but you will go there and follow the parade. So they do a good work. Plus, PSC, private security company. I had a colleague working on it. Personally, I didn't see so much initiative in this field, but it seems that, yeah, now there is a slight change, especially in near Batam, to help and to support the more governmental initiative. Of course, you have also now the new trend in Indonesia, Global Maritime Fulcrum, and you can feel that the sea is back. I remember before when I read Gadis Pantai, Pramudia Anantatur, about the fear of the fisherman when he has to go to the sea, or even Ratu Kidul, the opposite side. But now there is a different view. Than just see the sea in a different way. And today I saw there was a RSIS commentaries by our former colleague, precisely to recall about the recent steps by Indonesia to be back at sea. So, indeed, defense and security is not always the main pillars or priority, but still it's there. So. Better than nothing. And then also you have simply the human factor, because when you ask people to say, well, why actually not more, but much less pirate, and say, no, but because we have a new officer, very good one, very but doing a lot with a lot of ID initiative, and this is bring a new, wind of change, you know, in this area, and can help a lot when you have just a good leadership, new leadership over there, and with the establishment of the Western Fleet Quick Response Team. So now you have different, but this also, I had a colleague in Umrah University in Bintan who is working on it and telling that it helped a lot. And after, indeed, you have also some other factors. The chief of gang that I mentioned earlier, who came back, actually passed away. So, of course, not around anymore. So, maybe let's wait for somebody else to take over my Mr. Pong I mentioned earlier, maybe sooner or later, but just right now, they're not here anymore. Next, please. So, and just to explain as well that maybe no more pirates, because they moved to some other illegal business. This is an illegal migrant. By chance, I lost one afternoon on a beach in Karimun. I don't know what I was doing over there, but this is the beauty of research in Indonesia. Just, I was actively doing nothing. And then I saw this illegal migrant, so leaving to Malaysia. And so still, of course, you have this issue. A cigarette to Singapore sometimes. Granite also, or sand previously, now I don't know. And again, with either Malaysia or again, see Singapore, which is not that far away. Next, please. So, this will go quickly, no worries. So, next stage or for the near future, maybe to focus on some other areas, because indeed, the sea lanes of communication, Malacca Strait, maybe Makassar Strait, okay? But let's not forget some other areas of Jambi, for example, when you have fishermen who can be also attacked, but just because they are not connected to internet or they don't know about RECAP, IAC, etc. But still over there, you have an issue and concern. The trilateral maritime patrols, we know what happened in the Malacca Strait patrol. Very good at the beginning, everybody enthusiastic, but at the end of the day, people realized that two big vessel, I mean a patrol boat, we are not able to track pirates among the mangroves, etc. So letting the trilateral maritime patrol in the Sulu Sea, because same, you have now a deal, but sometime you have a meeting point and a meeting at sea between two navies. But talking about the hot pursuit, still pending. I mean, it's on the paper, but nothing in reality. So we will see in the future if it works. But so far, there is a decrease in Sulu Sea. So maybe we are, like in the Makassar Strait, the first stage to see that indeed, now let's be careful. But knowing that it's very different, Sulu Sea, most of the area is it's archipelagic waters, so it's not a strait. So meaning this is Philippines was to do the job mainly, and actually they are doing with the establishment on the new point of contact and base, so improving over there. Next please. So I will go quickly, but I wanted to finish with it because having talked and shared views with colleagues for the last few hours and days in Jakarta, and because we organized a seminar on this topic with the help actually of the French embassy in Jakarta, thank you very much again, in Bintan last October. Now, to say that actually there is a change of the context at sea, I mean in the international relation in general. That's what I say to my students. Now the police is sometimes doing the job of the military forces or with the equipment of military forces, because using tanks, helicopters, see what happened in Mexico, for example, or in the favela in Brazil, where they go with tanks, etc. But in the same time, you have sometimes military people doing the job of the police because to fight illegal fishing. So, meaning, again, it's much more complex than before, and you cannot differentiate. Okay, you do non-traditional security, Coast Guard, and you do just hard power and Navy stuff. It's much more blur, and you have a continuum like that. And I mean, my own cadets have to be trained to work together with the Attorney General, and sometimes every year we invite him to give a speech to our. But same for the police to work with the Navy. So it's quite a tricky issue. And that's why the model, the organization, Coast Guard versus Navy, is it still relevant? Not that sure. And you have so many agencies, but you cannot share, you know, the big cake, and because you have to work together. And Malaysia, Singapore, Philippines is starting on it as well. But Indonesia, we know about Bakamla. Again, the same for Bakamla, you have up and down. For a long time, and still now. So they are trying to find the good way to work. Next, please. To work on it, and for once, France, because we had our own model, but only for us actually, and we were a bit apart from the usual model, which is Coast Guard versus Navy. We have this model very specific, state action at sea. And then actually you have this guy who is like the maritime governor, and this maritime governor, his boss, is not the head of the Navy, this is a prime minister, so could be the president or whatever, and then he can work with all the agencies, so 12 in Indonesia or I don't know, and then if he need anything, you have a decree, I mean an arrêté, you have a decree, and with a list of mission, 40 plus mission, and then you have boxes, so this mission, this agency, this mission, and then this coordinator, most of the time it's a Navy officer, because this is a Navy which has the more asset, but could be whoever, and then, so he can pick, and then say, I need you there, etc. So meaning, they can work together, it's not a matter of having a big agency with a big budget, No need to add more assets. There are already the assets. But you need somebody just to coordinate. And this agency in Paris, actually, it's only 15 people, or roughly 15 people, to coordinate. They get info, I mean, from the minister, different ministries. And then, we talked about that earlier, you have one office, but very small, with 8 to 10 people. On a daily basis, they fuse information from all the agencies, they fuse information to send information to everybody. So, mean we share information all together. Of course, it's not ideal, but just I wanted to share it with you because actually you have some initiative in the Gulf of Guinea now, and it seems that it seems to be quite in mute or in phase, in tune with now the new context, especially in Southeast Asia and in Indonesia. Next, please. And promise this is a last slide. No, just because every time I talk about piracy, I think about, you know, Asterix and the indomitable Gauls. You know, it's something like that for the pirates. You know, every time you fight against the pirates, but you still have this small gang somewhere and an indomitable pirate. So what to do? You can have a new weapon. This is for the industry people. New people, you can maybe corrupt pirates with money. You can try to divide to conquer, I mean, the pirates. But it will be always difficult because actually the pirates have different faces and you have so many different pirates, so it will be tricky. Knowing that, oh yeah, I didn't tell you, but just to finish. No, because they use black magic. I didn't tell you, no? Okay, in move. No, because they say, with a bottle of water, say, what is it? No, it's a magic water coming from a Javanese dukun. Huh? Say, yeah, when I spread my sampan, this on the sampan, the sampan disappears. Say, no, but I see again. No, but at night, if you come back, no more sampan. And then that's why they have black magic. And then same, when they shoot the pirate, they say, no, the bullet cross the... And this is very interesting because I got the same kind of story in Malaysia. From somebody close to the police saying, pirate, not only walk, but run on the sea, and then phew, disappear in the cloud. But I say that to my cadets. I say, what do you do? If you smile, you will offend them. But maybe if you don't smile, maybe they will think you are naive. So it's a very, very, very difficult cultural interaction issue. But indeed, and no, just to tell you that why about this black magic? Because they are scared, they are not professional, that's what I told you. And that's why also it tells a lot, but this is another histoire, another story. No, because usually they use this black magic, in the same time they quote the Quran, they read the surah of the Quran, then they sacrifice some time chicken, see? Very avant-garde. They mix this together. So that's why they will still have the black magic, and because of this black magic, maybe in 10 years you will have a new or young researcher coming here to tell you, to give you a new presentation again about piracy in Indonesia, because most probably that will be still around, but with every time this different lesson, it's what I try to show you, what piracy tell or say about Indonesia or Southeast Asia. Thank you very much. So if you have any question or...
Yeah, thank you very much for your presentation. Now, if you have any question, please let me know.
Hello, my name is Alpha. I'm from Jakarta. Anyway, I have a question about the interesting point is where the pirates become like a Robin Hood. I was wondering if the government has a plan for that. I mean, it's not only deter them at the sea, but also like how to improve the life of the people at the shore. I mean, I assume that they go to the sea and do this thing because of economic factor. I'm just wondering because at one point we can deter them at the sea with military and police, but we have to. I mean, you're talking about the solving problem from the root. I mean, I think it's one of those are economic factor, and how the government thinking about what do you think, like, what do you think, how to solve the economic factor thing? Because I believe that we should think about how to develop this community at the shore so they don't go to the sea to do piracy. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Very important question. And you're right, actually, that's what is being done right now in Somalia, because I didn't compare that much with Gulf of Guinea or Somalia, but you have initiative in Gulf of Somalia by the International Maritime Bureau doing a great job on this specific topic. And this indeed echoes what I said about NGO who could also take over or take initiative. I'm thinking about this other NGO, OBP, Ocean Beyond Piracy, same, doing a great job of Somalia and a bit of in the Gulf of Guinea, and they are thinking now to move a bit to Southeast Asia. But same, this NGO precisely, you have a multi, I would say, with different approaches, I mean, to work not only at sea, but as I say, on land, and not only to prevent, to fight pirates, but also just to fight the root of piracy. So that's why NGO should do the job. And you're right, after it's a fight, if not talking about the Robin Hood, it's a fight of legitimacy in the village. People will follow those in whom they trust. I mean, bring money to the village. If you have corrupted official and then somebody fighting at sea to bring you money, so that's why indeed it's a big effort. And that's why among the different factors, I think the human factors, talking about leadership, people going there, and that's why when I do this research, for me it's also important to have a look on the BBK, I mean, yeah, Batam Intan Karimun Free Trade Zones, to meet this head of Batam Autoritas, to know what is done. And we had a colleague in RSIS who was publishing a radio bulletin, and this was helpful. Actually, that's why you have, but this is another issue, but what is security? And you have this definition by United Nations about human security. So when am I in security or secure or safe? Is it when there is no fight? Yeah, but if there is no fight, but in the same time, I don't have food, I don't have water, I don't have, etc., a proper clean environment, so I'm not safe. So that's why, indeed, this, they have to zoom out and to consider the full spectrum about security, and then the full spectrum of actors, and not only law enforcement agency, plus private actors, company to bring money and job, plus NGO.
Hi, my question is regarding, it's obvious that you made a lot of research on like the village level, on a personal level with the actual pirates, in addition to your research with, you know, different state actors and different governments. So I'm just interested in how you gained access to their world.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you very much. And because indeed, first it's not easy, and then we were talking about that this afternoon. Even for it raises question ethical issues sometimes to deal with them and with the data, etc. No, but just to it took a long time. Actually, just the time is the key, and that's why this is the beauty of PhD, because you have nothing else to do. No family, nothing, so just enjoy life. And that's why you can spend, as I said, one afternoon on the beach doing absolutely nothing, but you know that something can happen, so, and it happened, and then after I got the full story from. But and time is precious, because after I know when I moved to Singapore, that's why I said that just before we are talking, I went much more to Indonesia when I was based in France than when I was based in Singapore. Because in Singapore I was working, I have to go to the office every day. Huh? And then yeah, if you have to go to Indonesia, or you have to fill this form doing this. Well, so that's why, actually, it's because of my PhD, every time I had PhD, you know, you are very poor, but you are very rich to travel. You don't have food at home, but you are full of flight tickets. And then that's why I never stayed in Indonesia But I did many, many trips, especially over there, many weeks, and then back to France, then many weeks again, at least once, twice a year. And then I had to find first the province, then the island, then the village. And then every time it's one trip, huh? Then the village, and then in the village, the compound, and then in the compound, the house. And then after, you have to build a relationship. That's why we were saying, we are joking just before. But for me, it was more useful to know a lot on the English Premier League or Zinedine Zidane rather than Foucault. Because when you have to talk to them, you know, French philosophers, they don't care. But then you have to build this relationship to take time. And then also, what was indeed, to be more concrete, a key factor when this debate, discussion in Singapore about possible collision between terrorism and pirates, terrorists and pirates. And I remember I was there killing time again, walking. But you know, when you walk, it's like when you fish. You walk, but you know where you walk. You go to walk in places where you know that something can happen. So I was walking, and then somebody, hey, come, have a drink. I said, no. And I come, have a drink. Actually, I had nothing else to do. I went to, and then we talk. And then he said, so what do you do? Then, oh no, I'm doing a PhD. I was saying about, small lie, about economic crisis in Indonesia. And then I said, oh yeah, but you know, there is this debate, collusion, pirate terrorism. I said, personally, for me, it doesn't make sense. Oh yeah, it doesn't make sense. Yeah, you're right. Same for me, it doesn't make sense. And then he said, if you want to come to know a bit more about that, come back tonight at 12 in this period. No, come back tonight, minum kopi, and then I will go. And then I came back, and indeed, it was funny. For once, legend was in tune with the reality, because this was a one-eyed guy, and then we had to move because he knew sometime policemen in civilian attire in the coffee, and this guy, for example, was a former pirate, I would say, and then I built a relationship, but then indeed it takes a confidence, and that's why. I didn't want to have too many slides, but sometimes I have in mind, maybe you don't know, but this French anthropogeographer, Jean Mallory, who worked on Inuit people, so nothing to do Inuit people, but he said he worked on Inuit people in Greenland from the 50s until now, I mean until recently. And that's very interesting, precisely to work on the same population, people, even if there is decrease up and down. Because sometimes, you know, especially in Singapore, Paris no more, now it's South China Sea, so let's move to China much more. Yeah, but no, precisely you have to be faithful and still in touch with these people. So, yeah.
Someone else?
Yeah.
Thank you. Ahmed is my name. I will ask you about the Chinese and China factor. So first, at least in the past 3 years, the Malaysian found out that their heroes, the pirates, the Hang Tuah, Hang Jebat, Hang Kesturi, all that guys, the heroes, they are Chinese pirates. Okay, and in your slides, you have show us also Mr. Wang and so on, also still Chinese. And today, the leader of the ASEAN is Singapore. Singapore is style and majority also Chinese. And on the Spratly Island, there is China and the US. 4 weeks ago, I attend a seminar at America House. There was a promoter for the science who said that all the ASEAN countries should use the possibility for the in the science to get rid of the China from Spratly Island. So with the marine biology. So my question and my point is it what do you think in the future, in the coming months or coming years, with the leader of Singapore in the ASEAN, how will it develop with the piracy in this point? And How important is the point of China? Do we need China in Spratly Island or should go away from there? Regarding the piracy. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Of course, Singapore will do a great job, and I have to go back to Singapore. maybe Singapore in the audience, and that's why not easy. Huh? No, but of course, they will do a great job, and about China and piracy. Yes, tricky issue, huh? It seems that the big boss indeed were ethnically Chinese, but mostly from Malaysia or Singapore, but not from China, People Republic of China. So it's a big difference. And in the past, in the 1990s, indeed, you had a connection with China, for sure, because of hijacking. This was a time of Caparon 2, ghost ship, phantom ship, like the one I showed just now, when you change the name of the ship, like the Karaboudjan of Capitaine Haddock, which becomes the Jebel Amila in Crabe au Prince d'Or. But so you had this ghost phantom ship. So, and this, China was directly involved, but not Beijing corrupted people in the southern ports of China. And then when China joined the former GATT, l'OMC, WTO, yeah, World Trade Organization, so they had to clean a bit their, clean all these senior officials to kick out all these corrupted people. And then, by chance, suddenly, no more phantom ship to China or moving or passing through China. So that's why all this hijacking, this golden age of hijacking with big merchant vessels, so decreased and then no more. So that's why since then, since the early 2000s, China was out of the radar talking about piracy. Now, so this is one thing. As I said, the big boss are ethnically Chinese, but not Chinese from of China. And now, so far, I don't see any. Me personally, I don't have any clue about how China can be involved. And regarding piracy in the Spratlys, you don't have any incident over there. So. I think it's two different issues. But as I said, of course, piracy can be useful because we know how it works in the South China Sea. Sometimes you have so different level, and piracy can. And actually, it's always like that. This is one topic, one issue where everybody agrees. So this can be used, as I said, as a pretext. Precisely to share information and to work together. And I know, I heard that at the level of Coast Guard from China and some different Southeast Asian country, all these Coast Guard are working together, but underground, you know how it works, the track 2 level. And so that's why piracy, for that, talking about China could be useful. Well, I would say it could be useful more to cooperate than to fight. Do I answer the question? Or later we can continue.
Someone else?
Thank you very much for the chance for me to get a question. Well, my name is Adi Putra, and then something that is make me interest in this kind of discussion is that sea pirates nowadays is not a very hot issue, but actually it is still important because of the Indonesian as the Southeast Asian country which is developing in their seas, and then that the sea pirates itself located not only inside of the Indonesian archipelago itself, but actually it is stated that a country nearby the Indonesian archipelago, such as Philippines and then Singapore like that, also take control of that kind of sea piracy. And then, which means that our sea is nowadays is not safe enough because of the law enforcement itself is very, very low. That's why we see that sea pirates that doesn't only make the comprehensive of the only on charging or making other ships into their ships, and but also taking our resources such as fish. That's why our Ministry of Miss Sri Pujastuti stated and has actually destroyed all about the ship. That's why this is very interesting in me. And then what I want to see is how about the law enforcement agencies in your state of opinion? Because of law enforcement agencies, not only the border police, or actually not only the sea police abroad nearby the sea, on or actually what we call it in Indonesia ZEE or zona economy exclusive like that, but actually offshore. That's why this is this kind of thinking is make sense of me. That's because the sea pirates itself is a phenomenon. Like in 1990, the ethnical of Chinese has actually bring out their what we call it, a massacre, the flag of massacre that's happened, and they actually took parts and they move around, separated in some places nearby abroad in Southeast Asian countries such as Philippines, Malaysia, and Singapore. That's why. And then how about that kind of things? Do you have any, you know, any positive thinking, and then any argument which is stated that that kind of things is really need to be an important issue? And then how to make sure that that kind of sea pirates is sea piracy, actually not only sea pirates, sea piracy itself should be, you know, exaggerated like that. And then how about the law enforcement agency? Which agency that we can see as a law enforcement for this kind of massacre? Why I told this is a massacre? Because sea piracy is it is outside of the reach of one country, but actually it brings a disaster for the country itself in their sea or in their declaration like that. That's why I need you to state your mind and then give us the definition. Thank you very much, sir.
We thank you very much for your comments. So I will take it more as a comment. I don't know, I'm not so sure I will remember the question, but maybe just to for food for thought. No, you're right. Piracy and armed robberies against ships is only the emerged part of the iceberg. And then after you have all these other issues, and piracy is just one aspect, and I agree, illegal fishing, etc. is now a big issue, but which brings to the main issue, the hot topic, which is, as you said, the law enforcement agency. So I can just repeat what I said previously. As you said, and maybe to go a bit further, I said police doing the job of the military doing the job of the police, and then you have so different threats. You have hard power and sea denial, but in the same time you have all this non-traditional security. But what you add is that you have also different area. You have the territorial waters, you have the EEZ. EEZ is a big mess. What to do in EEZ, which kind of military activities in EEZ? There is a big debate among scholars about that. And then you have the ICES. So that's why you need not too much rigid system, organization, with different agencies, but they have to work together and they have to know that it's not a matter of rivalry, but it's just a matter of working for the country. And that's why you need somebody above to coordinate. But then after, I know that the head of the Navy has to agree, has to be fine to obey and to follow what the coordinator will say. And this is a big issue, but actually it shouldn't be a very expensive option, because you don't need, as I said, more assets. You can just use all the assets being here, and then afterwards, precisely, you have this small team to coordinate, like Kamla could do, and then after they can do the job. But then I forgot, again, your question was about China, no? Because I don't have any clue. I mean, any evidence or any material about involvement of China into piracy. I mean, except this individual initiative, criminal initiative, but nothing at all from China.
From the first side, they make the composition that say sea piracy itself, and then the ethnical itself make some kind of what we call it terroristic statement, like in Philippines. That's why there are some archipelagic state in province of some countries such as Philippines or Singapore, but actually it is not, you know, like it is illegal, but actually it is not from the Tiongkok itself, but actually it's an ethnical itself, but it happens in China, but not from the Republic of China itself. That's why that is the fact.
I don't know, but not to say anything. No, I don't know, I'm sorry. Yeah.
No, I just want to from your presentation, you said that the problem might start with that some people from the mountain that come to the cities and they need to find some jobs but don't have the skills. So this unskilled urbanization needs to resort to piracy to gain some money for life. So I'm just thinking that what we can do to improve this. So it's just like a scenario in my mind that maybe we could bring more education, so those people might be better, like can gain more skills and more educated, so they can get a better job than doing piracy. So I'm just thinking, if we have those kind of scenarios, then there will be more business in those cities. The cities will be bigger. There will be more business, more shipments to those cities, and that would means that will attract more piracy.
I mean, there is no magic potion, and to fight piracy, it would be too easy. And no, that's why comparison is always dangerous. I use the word coastal ghettos, and sometimes that's it. So what to do to reconnect with these coastal ghettos to the economic activities and administrative centers? And I know what happened sometime even in France. I mean, by volunteer, by NGO, etc., and then by public services. And that's why it's a work for the state to reconquer, I mean, to be back. You have the it's a kind of pioneer front, so that's why it matches with this project of Poros Maritim Dunia, because precisely the state has to be back to explore this pioneer front and then to restart, to revitalize this the local economy. But then after, you know how it works when in these far, far away provinces, when you have the local potentate or the local official, and then also doing their own business. So I followed what happened with a recent experience in Batam. It was not that easy to bring somebody from Jakarta to try to clean up a bit over there, and then actually he failed. So so that's why it's a big task. But regularly you have a president going there. So and let's hope. But indeed, it's a matter. I mean, that's why it's you know, this is a key word now, everything is comprehensive. But actually, it's true, this is a comprehensive security. And actually, that's what even the European Union did in Somalia, the comprehensive approach, because you have to fight at sea, but you have to train people on land, and you have to develop the economy, and then you have to, you know, this is peacemaking, building, enforcement, etc. So you have different stage, and then this is a full package. That's why I mentioned just previously the human security elaborated by the United Nations. This is the key issue. But then that's why, because many, as we said just now, different areas, so you have plenty of actors who can be involved. And, yeah.
So I just want to ask, is it better if we expose more of the piracy, or is it better if we underexpose it?
To expose, what do you mean?
Because you said there is some underexposed areas, so I mean, with this scenario like this, it can attract actually more piracy if you expose more.
No, I mean, when I say underreported areas, it's because, it doesn't appear in the statistics, but... But after the pirates themselves, they know that where the pirates are. Yeah.
Is it better if we expose more of them, so we can catch more of them?
Okay, someone else?
I just want to ask a question. So the piracy in Malacca Strait, the motive just to feed their family, right? Or just to fulfill their pengangguran, because they have no job, right? So they come from the mountain to the sea to become a pirate. That's in the Malacca Strait. But what happened in North Sulawesi or in the south of Philippines? Do they have connection with terrorism? I mean, what happened in Marawi? Do they have the connection with the piracy in the Philippines or North Sulawesi? Is the piracy in Malacca Strait have connection with terrorism or no? Or is just for just to feed the poor, that's it.
So I am better know the Malacca Strait because of field research rather than Sulu Sea. Malacca Strait, so far I don't see any evidence or proof the proper connection between terrorists and pirates. This is for sure. When I was in Singapore, there was this idea of connection with a group in the north of Aceh, but so far nothing. And then after, as I said quickly, there was this terror alert issued by the IFC in 2010, but actually even the liaison officer were not aware about that, so it was very blur and opaque to know from where it came, so nothing very consistent. And this is for the Malacca Strait. And regarding the Sulu Sea, it's very different because I would say initially there is a terror agenda, but as I said, with different kind of terrorists, because you have the one fighting for autonomy, for independence, or for the caliphate more recently. So it's very different kind of terrorists, so that's why some of them find to work together with the government, some other not at all, Tibet, etc. And then you have also those who are just interested in money. And this is very tricky, because sometimes they ask for these people to kidnap seamen. But then after, this group will bring the victims to the Abu Sayyaf related people, and there are those who will bargain, etc. And then they will give a bit of the money to those who kidnap, who did the job, and then they are very happy, they go away. And then these Abu Sayyaf related people will use their money for their own agenda. And then sometimes some people said, actually it's interesting, there was a kind of limit, logistics limit, about 30, 40, I don't know, hostages, because well, never ever there more than that. And then they had first to free some people before kidnapping some others. What happened over there, actually, we were talking about what to do with different actors, NGO, blah, blah, blah. This is idealistic. But Philippine people clearly, I mean, fought against them on land and tracked them with rifle, etc. And then I can tell you quickly the number of kidnap and ransom incidents decreased because in the base camp on land they were tracked by the military people. But now the big issue, because everything is entangled, I mean interrelated, people are concerned about what can still happen at sea, even if, and then now I'm moving away a bit from piracy, but and this is a key issue after having talked about that with a diplomat in the region, but saying now the concern is the transnational trafficking, smuggling, migration across the Sulu Sea. Maybe not to hijack, to kidnap anybody or what, but either to go to the southern Philippines to train, to connect, to meet people, to get, I don't know, weapon or whatever, or to go from southern of Philippines to, I don't know, Indonesia, Malaysia, Singapore, to perpetrate a terror attack. So there is a two-way. I don't know. The question, was Marawi the end of something or the beginning of something else? I don't know. Me, I felt it was more the end of something, I mean, the last try and then... No. But maybe it's also a beginning of a new way, because they gave up for the caliphate, but maybe now a new way of action. And because we know what happened in the past, with this connection, all the people were spread in Southeast Asia who can meet there, train, and then go. I don't know. But for sure, when we talk about our Pelabuhan Tikus in the Malacca Strait, this is a big issue around the Sulu Sea, the Pelabuhan Tikus or equivalent in Malaysia, Philippines, and then Sulawesi. I mean, I heard the stories about the connection. Even Nasir Abbas told me the way when he was a former emir of Jemaah Islamiyah, but for this area, precisely Sulu Sea, and then he said very easy to bring money or equipment or weapon from Malaysia to Indonesia. He said every day we went to buy fish to the same fisherman, and if one day I came with a packet to give the fisherman said, okay, no problem, you know me when I fish, and I did it. No, you don't know when you fish if you are in Malaysia, Indonesia or Singapore in the Malacca Strait, so same over there. He said, okay, I will give it to your friend in Indonesia. And then even somebody, big name now, told me that, you know, in Sebatik Island, you have houses in, actually the kitchen is in Indonesia, the living room is in Malaysia, so that's why the connection.
Excusez-moi, je voudrais parler français. C'est tellement envie de savoir mon français est compris ou pas. La question que je voudrais vous poser, c'est comparer avec les Somalis. Et c'est les pirates à Sumatra. Comparer avec les Somalis, les pirates de Malacca. Nous pouvons dire un petit voleur, n'est-ce pas?
Somalie? Non, mais...
En anglais, s'il vous plaît.
If I may to translate, the question is about to compare with a pirate in Somalia and a different kind of pirate. And thank you very much for this question. Indeed, again, of course, very simply, you can conduct field research in Sumatra, but in Somalia, it's a bit more difficult. So just this, to show that it's a very different situation, knowing that you have a failed state in Somalia, and you don't have any failed state in Indonesia. Sometimes you have gray areas, sometimes you have local potentate, okay, but that's all, it's not a failed state. So that's why it's a very different situation. Plus, you had a civil war, full country in Somalia, not in Indonesia, okay, maybe in Aceh for a while, and then indeed you had this debate about collision between pirate and gang people in the past, but again it's very different, it's not the full territory. So, and last I would say also a big difference, it's a relationship to death. Somali people don't care, dying, not dying, you know, they are the cat, I don't know how to pronounce, you know, meaning the brain is unplugged, and then when they go to sea, so they're not very lucid, and because they know the situation on land, so which is totally chaotic. So in Indonesia, very different, as I told you, they have a family, they have still a bit of expectation, hope to get a proper job later. They know that the day after they will go minimum copy quietly in the market. So that's why they don't want to, they're not ready to die. That's why they need all this superstition, this ilmu, this black magic to get confidence. But even if I have to admit that some people sometimes use drug, I mean, but precisely to get confidence. But that's why it's very different situation. I would say, same as I told you, as the chief of the village, it's under control in you. And if the situation has to be much worse, you will be able to press the buzzer and to say stop. And so in Somalia, you try, nothing happened. So that's why I think different. But you're right, I didn't compare same. Maybe Gulf of Guinea, it's a bit more similar because I didn't went into the details, but most of the attack now in Southeast Asia, actually, it's at birth, at anchor, meaning it's not underway, you know, as you can imagine in the movie. So, and it's the same in the Gulf of Guinea, and precisely in Gulf of Guinea, we have now partnership with France to establish this new model organization, precisely to coordinate law enforcement agencies.
Maybe one last question.
Thank you. I want to know if you think that that ASEAN can create an agency like Frontex, or is it possible? Is it not possible?
Yeah, you're right. But I don't know. I mean, it could have done it before, and many opportunities for a long time. But maybe now is a new community, because now of Singapore, indeed, maybe it's time to do it. And maybe because indeed there is this discussion about, as we said just now, the at the Coast Guard level. I heard this word, and actually it rings a bell to me, Coast Guardization in Singapore, and maybe indeed this is a new trend, and based on it, maybe they can work, because it's not the Navy, so maybe it's easier, they can work. But knowing that, talking about the Navy, actually, you have annually the meeting of the Chief of the Navy within the ASEAN, so you have, technically, you have already, the boxes are there. I mean, you have the meeting of the Ministry of Defense, you have the meeting of the Chief of the Navies. So, and now maybe via the Coast Guard, and I know, that's what I told you, you have already a small group of states working together quietly on it. And but the point is, it seems that now countries are more keen to work, you know, on a minilateral level, meaning 3-4 states rather than ASEAN level. But let's see. Now we have Singapore is a chair indeed for the next year. So maybe we can expect it. But we said that 10 years ago, that's why I'm a bit I'm a bit careful. Yeah.
Okay, thank you very much, Eric.
Thank you very much.
Now maybe, I'm sorry, but it's time to finish, but if you have other question, you
no,
can...
Actually, it's not a question. I just want to give and share experience or actually the policy that actually happened in government related to the, you know, pirates and development. So this is, my name is Julia, I'm from UNESCO. Just want to share to you about, because most of the piracy happen in the coastal area, so I think you should also see how actually the development in the point of view of from the development sector, because if we actually look into economic, that you know the people there in the village actually become pirates because they have like limited like of access to the economic. That's just one point, but another point is that they feel disappointed about the government because the inequality of the development that happened in their area. Actually, there are a lot of community-based program that is implemented by the government of Indonesia. One is, there are two actually that I'm familiar with. One is the Sapa Sisir. So it's a village coastal program. It's from the KKP, the Maritime and Fisheries Ministry, that actually have this program in the coastal village that actually help the people to improve their life, their livelihood. And you also need to see the policy from the BAPENAS, the National Development Agencies, in which they have the special director that actually managing the coastal small area and isolated area. So if you mention that that will be like, you know, the NGO who actually doing that, well, that's quite difficult because right now the NGOs here also struggling to get the funding for their project because Indonesia is no longer a developing state, instead it's a developed country in which most of the donor will actually, you know, withdraw their support and monetary assistance to Indonesia. But there's also a one is from the government program and policy. Two is, of course, there are several good examples from the university that actually they sent their student to do community work in the island to build the coastal village. And that's already done by the, for instance, like University of Indonesia, University of Defense, Indonesia Defense University. So by encouraging, you know, the university, the academician to have more focusing on developing the coastal village, that will be one part how actually we can actually reduce the Piracy Act in Indonesia. And in Indonesia it's also complicated if we are talking about law enforcement, because law enforcement at sea, at island, it involving a lot of agencies. It will involve the police department, it will involve the Indonesian Coast Guard, it will involve the Navy, etc. But then you have to see what will be like their job description, what will be like their focusing in the context of defense for the, because each of them actually have different mandate and responsibility. So you also need to analyze from that point of view. I think that's all. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Now, if you want, you can go outside and continue to discuss around some food and some juices. Again, thank you very much, Eric.